Good evening, everybody. On behalf of the Center for International Human Rights, I would like to welcome you all to this evening's event, which is in celebration of International Women's Day, and the topic is assault on campuses, sexual assault on campuses, issues and prospects. There are two reasons that we decided to focus on this issue for International Women's Day. First of all, because it is a very serious problem that very often falls below the radar screen, and it is an issue that needs to be addressed and addressed urgently by the university communities across the country. By the way, speaking about that, I would suggest that you all go and see a very powerful documentary which opened last week here in New York called The Hunting Ground, which discusses about the issues of sexual assault on campuses. It starts in very idyllic ways, students getting their acceptance letters at the university, and then all hell breaks loose and demonstrates how negligent, in fact, criminally negligent often university administrators are on issues of sexual assault. The minimum somebody expects as a somebody who is on campus is to have their physical integrity protected, and when this does not happen, then the university to take prompt and effective action to punish the wrongdoers, something that does not happen also. So it is an issue, and I hope that with this event we can start a conversation here on campus on this issue and how we can most effectively address it, and also what the student community, together with the faculty and staff, can do about raising awareness on this critical issue area. The second reason that we chose this as a theme is because often we, as well as other organizations, when it is a big day on the human rights calendar, like International Women's Day, we think in terms of events beyond this country's borders. Okay, and we have addressed issues, for example, of sexual violence in conflict situations. International Women's Day is examining countries like Sierra Leone, Liberia, DRC, Democratic Republic of the Congo, and so on and so forth. Well, once in a while, it is nice to try to bring the human rights conversation back home in this country, because this is a very serious human rights issue that we need to be talking about. And I'm very pleased that we have a distinguished group of panelists to do this for us this evening. And our speakers are Jennifer Gaffney, who is Deputy Chief, the Sex Crimes Unit, New York County District Attorney's Office. Her presentation will be followed by Jessica Greenfields, who is the Women's Center Counselor, Gender-Based Violence Prevention and Response Advocate, Women's Center, here at John Jay. And we'll conclude with Jan-Lisa Huttner, who is Director of College-University Relations from the Empire State Virtual Branch of the American Association of University Women. Before I give the floor to our presenters, I would like to thank once again our terrific staff, without whose help this event would not have been possible, as well as all the organizations that co-sponsored with us the event this evening. Thanks to all of you for being with us this evening, and the floor is yours. It's up to you.
Okay, so I'll sit and then I can, but the problem is I have really bad vision. So okay, I actually think I have to stand if I'm gonna see what I'm up to. Is that okay? So I'm Jen Gaffney, I'm Deputy Chief of the Sex Crimes Unit here in New York County. My unit prosecutes all of the sexual assault of victims 15 years and older that occur in this county.
Okay. And as well as some other crimes that are related to sexual assaults, we work on human trafficking cases, unlawful surveillance cases, and violations of the sex offender registry. So
I want to talk to you a little bit. Try to do it in 15 minutes. The goals of my presentation, I want to talk to you a little bit about what the New York State penal law defines as sexual assault, because that's the framework that our office works in, so that you know if
victims or survivors are ever talking to you about, you know, what is actually criminally liable in New York State. The benefits of reporting sexual assault to law enforcement. I know there's so much media lately about campus sexual assault and lots of issues about, you know, when do cases get reported and why they do and why they don't. So I'm sort of here to make a pitch for why we would love to see more reporting. And if we have time, I'll explain the arrest to sentencing process for victims and survivors. So basically, in New York State, our sexual assault laws are defined in the penal law. Every sexual assault has two elements. You're going to have a sex act, and then you're going to have some legally defined theory of how the victim did not consent. It's called lack of consent. Our sex crimes, you hear the words rape, you know, first degree, second degree, third degree. There are basically three categories of sexual assault. There is rape, which in New York State is defined only as penetration of the vagina by the penis. It's penetration, however slight, but it requires penetration. Then criminal sexual act is another category of sexual assault. That covers anything that we would consider oral sex or anal sex. Any contact between the mouth and the anus, the mouth and the penis, the mouth and the vulva, the penis and the anus, that's considered criminal sexual act. They're different titles, but under the law, the consequences for offenders are the same. So if you forcibly rape a person or you forcibly anally rape a person, your sentencing structure is going to be the same. The consequences will be the same for the offender, sex offender registration, but the names of the crimes are different. And then we have sexual abuse. That's sort of our catch-all crime. Touching of the sexual or intimate parts of a person. It's over or under their clothing. It can be touching of the actor by the victim or touching of the victim by the actor for the purpose of sexual gratification. So sexual abuse can be anything from, you know, the creep on the subway that rubs up against a person's buttocks in their clothes. That's a sexual abuse in the third degree. It's sexual contact with an intimate part over the clothing. Sexual abuse can also be a forcible sexual abuse. Someone that forcibly penetrates someone's, you know, anus with their fingers, that would be considered a sexual abuse in the first degree. So those are our three categories. And then to distinguish between the degree, do we have a first degree rape, a second degree rape, a third degree rape? It depends on what is the lack of consent. What is the theory that the lawyers are using to argue that this victim didn't consent to the act. Just so you know, in New York State, the age of consent is 17, so any sexual intercourse or of any type with a person under 17 by an adult is automatically going to be at least sexual misconduct or a crime. So I'll go over the theories that you most often see in a sort of college or campus situation. Our first-degree sexual assaults include sexual assault by forcible compulsion. Forcible compulsion is using either physical force against the victim or the threat of physical force, an express or implied threat of immediate physical injury or kidnapping to the victim. So it can be, forcible compulsion can happen by threatening a person with a weapon, a knife, a gun, even, you know, a box cutter, something where they fear physical injury. Physical forcible compulsion can happen with just the sheer use of physical force, someone that actually pins a person down with their body weight, with their size. You look at all of those factors. The place where the sexual assault happens sometimes is a component of physical force. Sometimes we have victims who are cornered and pushed into the corner of an elevator, a place where they can't get away. Threats or prior violence can sometimes be a factor in a forcible sexual assault. Often in intimate partner violence situations, you'll see someone who physically assaults their partner, perhaps punches them, smacks them, beats them, and then takes a little bit of a break and then demands intercourse. They're not using physical force in the moment of intercourse, but they're basically saying, well, let's do this now because you don't want that to happen again. That's an implied threat of physical force, which would be a first-degree sexual assault. another theory of lack of consent we have for first-degree sexual assaults is the physically helpless victim. It is a crime to have sexual contact or sexual intercourse with a person who physically cannot indicate their lack of consent. So this is a person who's either sleeping or unconscious, basically. How we most often catch these cases, catch these offenders, is when victims fall asleep and awake to a sexual act being performed upon them. Sometimes you find evidence of these crimes when the victim is completely unconscious or asleep and someone else walks in on it, but otherwise a victim has to sort of wake up to it to know it happened. There are times, which I'll get to, where somebody thinks they were the victim of a crime and very well may have been, but we don't know what happened, and that becomes a proof problem. Someone who falls asleep or passes out, wakes up, and feels like something happened. Maybe their clothes are amiss, something physically feels wrong, but there's this gap in memory. Those are cases we investigate to see whether we can prove that this happened. Our second degree theories in New York State include mental incapacitation. That's the legal term. A person is mentally incapacitated when they're temporarily unable to appraise their conduct due to a narcotic or an intoxicating substance that was given to them without their consent. And legally, we have to actually corroborate this crime. We have to have evidence beyond just the word of the victim in this particular subcategory of sexual assault. Sometimes the line between mentally incapacitated and physically helpless can be very blurry, and it's something that as the law enforcement we're often investigating to see what happened and what can we prove. If a victim is intoxicated, voluntarily or not, the victim goes out and, you know, if a victim voluntarily goes out and drinks a whole bunch, uses drugs voluntarily, and then falls asleep or passes out as a result, and a person decides to have sex with them, that is a physically helpless rape. If a victim is drugged by someone else without their consent, then someone has sex with them, that's a mentally incapacitated rape. They're drugged, and so they're acting in a way that they would not have but for the drugs. However, if a victim is voluntarily intoxicated, right, they take whatever the substance is themselves, and they're still awake and engaging in the act of sexual intercourse or whatever sex act it is, and perhaps they wouldn't have done that if they weren't in that state. In New York State, that's right now not a crime. It's not a crime if the victim is still awake and participating if they were voluntarily intoxicated. So, like I said, it's our job to investigate these cases and to try to figure out what we can prove. And we're often presented with survivors who don't have a very clear memory of exactly what happened. Like I said, you so often have people who wake up and think, all right, I remember I was last at this place, you know, maybe having drinks with a friend at a party, and now I woke up in this place and I have an entire memory gap of what happened in between, and it's our job to try to piece together that in between. So I mentioned the difference because it's very different than a lot of university policies. It's different than, if you're reading a lot about sexual assault lately, I think you guys are under the affirmative consent standard, right? That's not, it doesn't comport with the penal law. So there are sexual violations that are violations of campus policies that won't rise to the level of a crime. So there are times where we meet victims and we have to tell them that we can't prosecute their case. Third degree sexual assault. This is for rape and criminal sexual act only. It doesn't, if a victim is under 17 and the defendant is 21 or more, we have this statute that people love to call the no means no statute. That's not actually what it says in the penal law, but that's how people define it. The language of the statute is that at the time of the act of sexual intercourse or oral or anal sexual conduct, The victim has clearly expressed that they're not consenting to the sex act, and a reasonable person in the actor's situation would have understood under the totality of the circumstances that the victim is clearly not consenting. So this is a person who is actually saying no, or basically indicating that they don't want to have sex, and the defendant knows that, and they go ahead and they do it anyway. These are cases where the victim is often in a compromised situation where they're either very scared or they're weak or they're confused, so the defendant's not using force because they don't have to. It's actually even easier for them to accomplish their mission. So an example of this, I had a young woman once who was out with friends, became really so intoxicated that she started vomiting in a bar. So she's embarrassed and she walks out of the place on her own, and she left her friends because she felt embarrassed. And a complete stranger picks her up and pretends to be a taxi driver and then says he'll drive her home. And she somewhat passes out in the car and then comes to, and he gets on top of her and starts having sex with her. He didn't use force. She was so confused. She was sick. She had no idea where she was, that she was very weakly saying, no, I don't want to do this. So under the totality of the circumstances, right, you can say that defendant in that situation knew that when she's saying the word no, she means no. She has no idea who you are. You've never met her before. She's clearly intoxicated. That is a crime. So that's an example of, you know, what would fall under this. Unfortunately, the law interprets this very strictly. The victim has to clearly express no. So I had a different case where a victim was having consensual sex in a hotel room with a partner, and then lays down. It's a hotel room where it's very dark. The curtains are drawn. You know how the hotel rooms get so dark when the curtains are drawn, like it's almost black. And a friend of her consensual partner literally sneaks into the room and starts having sex with her. She thinks it's her partner because who else would be in the room until she feels her partner's face touch hers and realizes that there's someone else there, gets up, yells, and so I charge that as criminal sexual act in the third degree under the theory that under the totality of the circumstances, obviously, you know that she doesn't want you to perform oral sex on her, but the judge dismissed that count and said she never said no. She didn't have an opportunity to say no because it was pitch black in the room. But so the courts do interpret that pretty strictly. there are lots of other penal law crimes. You know, you can't have sex with a doctor can't have sex with their patient in the course of treatment, and a parole officer can't have sex with their parolee and things like that I'm not going to talk about because they're beyond sort of the scope of what's happening on campus. I do want to mention this crime, though, unlawful surveillance. It's not technically a sexual assault, but it's a registrable sex offense, and it's something that we have seen happen on campuses. This is a crime where people either secretly, without permission, videotape or record a consensual sex act, but the recording is without permission. That's a crime. Or people who, in New York City, it happens in the subways a lot, like to go with their cell phones and film up the skirts of women and film their intimate parts, sometimes film under bathroom stalls and dressing room stalls. That's a crime. It's a felony. It's a crime that's sort of sexual in nature, obviously. And we see this. People who do it in bathroom stalls and on subways usually get caught in the act. We often see it with victims in intimate partner violence situations where there's been consensual sex that's been video recorded, and then when there's a breakup, the offender uses that to threaten them. You don't want to break up with me, or I'm going to put this on the internet. I'm going to show this to your mother, that type of thing. I'm going to send this to your job. So that's a crime. If it happens to anyone you know, they should report it. So as the DA's office, what can we and can't we prosecute? I'm running out of time. Right?
Okay, a couple of minutes.
We have like I said, not everything that comes to us we can prosecute, but we do our best to investigate it. If our standard of proof is proof beyond a reasonable doubt. the word of a victim is proof. So if we can make out all of the elements of a crime, we don't need corroboration, but we need proof beyond a reasonable doubt. Most important, if you encounter someone that's a victim or survivor of sexual violence and they're saying, should I report it? Should I report it just to the school? Should I report it to law enforcement? Should I not report it at all? I would say, first and foremost, if it's just happened, you always want people to get medical treatment. Mm-hmm. Always. The New York state law requires that if a victim presents to the hospital within 96 hours of a sexual assault, they're required to do a forensic evidence collection kit, which looks both for injuries that may have occurred as a result of a sexual assault, as well as collecting forensic evidence, DNA evidence, things that will corroborate the sexual assault. If you go to the hospital for such a kit, they also give you prophylactic medications for STDs, HIV, and all of that. So it's very important to go to the hospital if you're a victim so that you can get the medical care that you need. A lot of the medications, if you don't take them within a 72-hour period, they won't be effective. So they won't give them to you after that. With the forensic evidence collection, they have found semen and DNA evidence up to 96 hours, which is why that's the time period that the state has to do the kit. After that, the evidence is often gone. If you have a sexual assault kit at a New York State hospital that doesn't require you to report the crime to the police or any law enforcement, you have 30 days. The hospital is required by law to hold that kit for 30 days. So if someone is assaulted and confused and doesn't know what to do, they can get medical treatment without feeling that they have to immediately deal with the police or detectives or DA's office or anything like that. What it does is it preserves evidence in the event that they do want to go forward with a case. It makes their case that much stronger and easier to prove. And like I said, it gives you the medical treatment that you need, the medications that you need. And also, most of the hospitals in New York City have advocate programs and social workers that can help victims with healing and the other half of healing beyond physical injury. Why involve law enforcement as opposed to just going to school? Well, like I said, reporting early gives you the best chance of a successful prosecution. You know that we read about sexual assault all the time and everyone says, oh, it's he said, she said. And jurors have lots of biases. You know, people don't like to believe that someone's been sexually assaulted. If I were to walk down the street tonight in the dark after this presentation and a complete stranger mugged me and I saw him for 2 seconds and I testified in court 6 months from now, hey, that's the guy that robbed me, everyone would say, she looks normal, she's a lawyer, yeah, he probably robbed her, he's guilty. If I go home and my partner sexually assaults me that I've known for the last 10 years and I go to court and say, he sexually assaulted me, there's this, well, all right, she looks normal, but I don't know, maybe she was secretly having an affair. There's always this speculation. Maybe she was mad at him for something else. Like, jurors love to speculate that there's some other reason because people don't like to believe sexual assault happens as often as it does. So to the extent, even though the law doesn't require it, to the extent that we can corroborate little things, it helps us prosecute. It helps get jurors over those misconceptions and biases. So a little bit of DNA, the smallest injury, sometimes you have, you know, a fingerprint that a hospital notices, corroborates that you were held down. Those types of things help prosecutions. Reporting to law enforcement early gives them the opportunity to look for other evidence. They can preserve digital evidence, text messages that might have been sent by the offender, emails. We can sometimes recover things that have been deleted. Law enforcement can go look for video surveillance, not just on your campus, but if people were out earlier, things that may have happened on the street, in a bar, in a club. So the more evidence we can preserve, the stronger it is if a victim wants to go forward, and a lot of that evidence is gone quickly. So benefits of reporting are obviously if you do report, no one's ever going to force you to go forward in New York County. No one's going to say, hey, you have to go through with this case. But it gives you options. If someone reports a sexual assault and the offender is convicted, the repercussions follow that offender. Wherever he or she goes, they'll have a criminal record. They'll be a registered sex offender. And if there's an issue of safety, if it's a relationship, there'll be an order of protection that will go beyond campus. I've met people who've had campus orders of protection, and then the offenders have violated that, you know, in Starbucks, and it's not a crime because there's no legal violation of a campus order of protection outside of campus. And finally, from a law enforcement perspective, you know, sexual offenders are recidivists. So there's nothing, you know, from my perspective as a DA, someone commits a rape on a campus in Manhattan, that offender might go commit a rape with a person that they meet at a bar a week later. And we don't see that pattern. It's harder for us to catch that offender because we don't know about the one. When you can draw patterns, it helps you solve crimes, and it helps you, you know, convict the people who are offending. So I will cut it short. I have too much to say, but I'll answer questions later.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Jennifer. Jessica.
Hi, everyone. So thank you all for coming out tonight with this kind of gross weather. I'm so happy to see so many of you here. My name is Jessica Greenfield. I am the Women's Center Counselor and Gender-Based Violence Prevention and Response Advocate. So I have the world's longest title, but it's important. And I am going to talk to you today about a few different things. I want to start off with just a little overview about what Title IX is and the context of this important issue that we're dealing with, and that kind of created this niche position for me that I've been doing for a long time, but suddenly has just become a big deal, which is great. And then I want to tell you a little bit about our CUNY policy, and I'm really glad that Ms. Gaffney just talked, because we do have a lot of similarities, but also some differences between the penal code and our CUNY policy. So I'm going to highlight some of those. And then finally, I'm just going to talk a little bit about resources on campus and some of your different options around reporting, and specifically what the Women's Center does and some of the programs that we have. So to start off with Title IX, how many of you know about Title IX, know what it is, have just sort of heard of it? Okay, great. That's great. I've been doing these presentations for a little while, and those numbers are slowly increasing. At first, it was just like crickets. But for those of you who are not as familiar, Title IX is a civil rights law. It was passed in 1972, and back then we talked about, you know, discrimination based on sex. Now we're talking more in terms of gender. But back in 1972, we said we used the term sex. And so Title IX is a educational amendment, and it really says that no person in the United States should be excluded from participation in education because of their sex. Now we're really talking in terms of gender. But so a lot of the early cases around Title IX, if you were to kind of research it, had to do with sports, had to do with schools not offering sports teams for women, or schools not allowing, you know, women opportunities to play on sports teams. Now, if you Google Title IX, you'll find that we are talking about it a lot in terms of gender-based violence, right? So we say that any time that there's gender-based violence, whether it's sexual harassment, sexual assault, sometimes intimate partner violence and stalking fall under this umbrella too. If that's happening, it gets in the way of somebody's ability to succeed or succeed as much as they possibly can in their educational experience, right? Because if you are being sexually assaulted, if you're in a violent relationship, how could those things not impact you in your life? And part of your life is your school. So we have started talking about this a lot, and under this law, schools have an obligation and a responsibility. I like to talk about it more in terms of like responsibility and commitment to protect students and to respond in the event that these things are happening, right, on campus. So in light of all of that, and this is what was touched upon at the beginning too, that there are about 100 schools right now. And Title IX covers anything, any school that receives federal funding, which is basically almost all schools, from pre-K and elementary school all the way through graduate school. There are about 100 schools right now that are under investigation for Title IX for things related to sexual assault, intimate partner violence, and really it's been that students have made reports and have felt that the school has not handled it as they are responsible for doing so. So it's kind of a big thing in the news. I would encourage you all to sort of check it out and see what kind of activism is being done around it. It's really inspiring. But I want to tell you a little bit and spend a few minutes talking about our CUNY policy. And we just passed on January 1st a new version of our CUNY policy related to these issues. And the policy, so I'll tell you a little bit about what it covers, focus specifically on consent because that piece is important, and then about the reporting options, right? So our policy for all of CUNY, it applies to all the CUNY schools, covers sexual harassment, gender-based harassment, and sexual violence, which we use as an umbrella term, right? So sexual harassment being any kind of unwelcome conduct of a sexual nature that's sufficiently serious to get in the way of somebody's educational experience. So those are things like unwelcome sexual advances, requests for sexual favors, and we also, in this category, specify abuse of technology. So this actually falls in line with what Ms. Gaffney was talking about in terms of the unlawful surveillance piece. We say in our policy, if you're taking pictures of somebody and distributing them without their consent in a compromised, if someone's in a compromised position, you're taking pictures of them or distributing videos, that's a violation of our CUNY policy. Gender-based harassment, any unwelcome conduct of a not specifically sexual in nature, but that's based on actual or perceived sex. So this really relates to gender identity and discrimination a lot of times around, like, our LGBTQ students. We spell that out in our policy, that that is something that is not going to be accepted and that there is a punishment for that. Also, the third category, which is sexual violence, which is an umbrella term, including sexual assault, intimate partner violence, and some forms of stalking. So, the another important piece of this policy, we specify what we mean by consent. And this is an interesting point, right? Because CUNY policy and the New York State schools and a lot of educational institutions around the country have adopted what we call an affirmative consent policy. So, unlike the penal law, our policy is a lot more strict about what consent means. It's this idea that there has to be explicit and clear voluntary communication that both parties want to engage in the sexual activity. So that is this idea that yes means yes, not no means no. And the absence of no does not mean yes, right? That's really kind of the crux of affirmative consent. Silence does not mean consent. So this is different than in New York State, which means that something could be a violation of our policy and a survivor could have resources through the school even if the case doesn't rise to the level that it could be prosecuted through New York State. And one of my jobs is really to help walk students through that because I know it can be a little confusing and a little hard, especially when you've been just, you know, victimized, to sit down and really understand all your different options. So part of my job is really to help provide people with all the information about their options and talk with them so that they can make informed decisions about, hey, you know, maybe this is something that I really want to report to NYPD. Maybe this is something that I really want to report to our Title IX coordinator because I know it's a violation of our policy, even if it's not a violation of the law in the state. So what are the options in terms of reporting? CUNY created three categories. And what I have been telling people is if you're concerned about confidentiality and you want to talk to somebody and be sure that that person is going to not disclose anything that you've said, there are a category of people that are confidential. And that's primarily myself and the counseling department and their nurse practitioner. We are bound by confidentiality, which means you could come and meet with me, and that conversation stays in that room. We take that very seriously. We're all licensed professionals. I'm a licensed clinical social worker, so we're bound by our ethics, but also our policy really specifies that those group of people are confidential resources. Now, that doesn't preclude you from saying, I want to talk to you, and I also want to make a report. But it's just to know if you're concerned about confidentiality or you have questions about confidentiality, come to the counseling department, come talk to me. There are a category of employees that we call responsible employees under Title IX, and those are people who are obligated to make a report to the Title IX coordinator if a crime or a violation of the policy was disclosed to them. So those are people like the Vice President for Student Affairs, people in the Dean's Office, people who work in student life, the college president and the deans, chair people for departments, and human resources staff. There's a whole list of people who are obligated to make a report to the Title IX coordinator if information is disclosed, which means that that's going to start an investigation. And a lot of times, that's great, and that's what people want. But we want people to be clear about what's going to happen, you know, when you disclose to different individuals. And then the third category is faculty, and faculty are encouraged to make a report, but they are not obligated to report to the Title IX coordinator. If you report to the Title IX coordinator, she's fantastic, and she's going to sit down with you and talk about what happens, what you would like to see happen, and you guys will also talk about resources, whether it is, you know, accommodations for classes, or you need some kind of, you know, different scenario if you're interested in pursuing disciplinary action. That's all things that the Title IX coordinator handles. I work with her very closely. If you think of, you know, she's the one who does the investigations, I'm on the sort of victim services and advocacy side of it. So I'm in student affairs, and I provide kind of information, referrals, and resources, as well as doing personal counseling. We work very closely with public safety, and we always tell people, you know, like, when in doubt, if you're concerned about your safety, go to public safety, because they will help. They do make great accommodations for people. They'll walk people to the subway. They also, I work with them when someone wants to make a connection with the NYPD, and we can figure out, you know, what precinct the person needs to go to, and if there is a specific person they need to talk to at that precinct, so that the survivor doesn't feel like they're kind of on their own juggling all this. But those are sort of the three components. I work very closely with the public safety office, the Title IX coordinator, and then my office, which is the Women's Center and Counseling. So that's a little bit about the policy, and I just want to spend maybe my last, you know, 2 or 3 minutes telling you a little bit about the Women's Center, what we do, how this all relates, because part of this work also has to do with prevention, right? So we are very focused on how we address these issues before they happen. Because if there's a way to prevent sexual violence, then why not do that? And then we still have all these interventions and these resources for when it does occur, but what can we do to change the culture on campus and to really create a community of safety and respect so that these crimes and these violations don't happen in the first place? So through the Women's Center, we have adopted a kind of multifaceted approach. We have the services, the intervention services. We also do a lot of primary prevention programming, which looks like things like, you know, we focus on healthy relationships. We talk about respect. We talk about how to have good sex. So we shift the focus a little bit so that people can start to talk together about doing things that are going to promote a culture of safety and respect and not lead to the perpetuation of violence. We also have things like we offer in connection with the Women's Empowerment Society, which is a student club here. We do self-defense workshop. We have yoga classes. We have a birth control clinic where we have doctors come in once a semester, and they meet with students, and they'll write up to a year's worth of birth control prescriptions completely free, and we talk about safe sex and healthy sex and how to promote attitudes of healthy sexuality. And then the other thing that we do is we do a lot of bystander intervention trainings. So we have a group right now called Men Can Stop Rape that have come in and are talking to athletic teams. They talk to the UMI, and their whole goal is changing the culture around what's tolerated. So even things like when, you know, you have a friend who says a disrespectful joke or is derogatory towards women, what do you do? How do you say, like, whoa, that's not okay, you know, without putting yourself in danger? And how do we start to make those changes on a social, cultural level so that it starts to change the culture around what's accepted with sexual violence? So I think that's pretty much what I wanted to say. I'm right here on campus in the Women's Center. We're in L6710. So I know we'll take questions at the end, but I love to talk to students anytime they want to get in touch with me. So I'm here for you guys who are students as a resource. And thanks again for having me.
Thank you, Jessica. Jan?
Hate my presentations because the questions that I get are often so interesting that I want to make sure that I remember what they are. So let me just check and make sure that I'm still recording. Yes, I am. Okay, so we want to have the film clip up first. So I'm short. I'm so short. How many of you watched the Oscars last month? Okay, not many, which is in this case good. How many of you are aware of what was called the white Oscar problem of 2015, which is that no actors of color were nominated in any of the four categories, best actor, best actress, best supporting actor, and best supporting actress? Are you aware of what was called the white Oscar problem and that there were protests of the white Oscar problem at this year's Academy Awards? No, not more of you? Okay. And how many of you are aware that there was also a blue Oscar problem at the Academy Awards this year, and that no women in any of the creative categories, best director, best original screenplay, best adapted screenplay, that there were no women nominated this year? How many of you are aware of that? So nobody was aware of that. But okay. So this is a huge problem. Because it means that all the films that you are seeing in the multiplex and even in a lot of the art houses, all the films that are given buzz and prestige come to attention and also make money are made by one half of the population, and the other half of the world population just, you know, might as well, nobody speaks for them at the movies. So this has become a huge issue for American Association of University Women. We created a project called With a Swan, Women in the Audience Supporting Women Artists Now, and that led to a collaboration between American Association of University Women and an organization called Women Arts, which is the Fund for Women Artists, to create a project called International Swan Day, where SWAN stands for Support Women Artists Now. So, okay, so does everybody have a copy of the handout? Okay, so every time the Oscars roll around and I point out how dismal the statistics are for women's representation in the creative categories, people say, well, you know, do women want to make movies, or, you know, are women interested in making movies, or what, you know, name a movie? And I name movie after movie after movie, and of course no one's ever heard of those movies, which is devastating and so shocking. And one person, a fellow film critic, actually said to me not too long ago, well, you're such a feminist, how come you think there should be best actress and best actor? You know, why shouldn't there just be best performance? And I said, well, that's a great idea, because then we'll have no women there at all. You know, if we don't even have best actress and best supporting actress, then women are just there to be arm candy. You're not there to be an artist in any way. So I'm going to start out with a 2.5 minute clip, very much obviously related to the topic tonight. And I'm going to give you an example of what it is that's available to you in the movie theater, but how many of you have heard before tonight of the film Afternoon Delight? It only ran for 4 weeks in theaters. At its peak, it was only shown in 39 theaters across the entire United States and Canada. And the gross revenue was under $175,000, which is, as we say in New York, bupkis. So, and yet, it won't surprise you to hear that many of the themes that women filmmakers address are issues of sexual violence. So I'm going to show you a 2.5 minute clip from a film called Afternoon Delight. It takes place about 2/3 of the way through the movie in the climax of the film. And obviously this woman is not a college age student, so this is something that's been haunting her and plaguing her for a good 10 years when we come into the story. And I want you to watch the faces.
So we want to put the lights out.
So I was funny. A freshman at USC.
Oh, God.
In my first week, and I was in my dorm room getting ready for my sorority rush, because that's what all the cool kids were doing. And this guy, oh my God, is it Mike or John?
No name.
It's Mike. John. Mike. Mike?
Where is this
Oh
going?
My God.
Not anywhere good.
I fucking don't know his name.
Yeah. Anyway.
He just came walking on into my dorm room.
It happened. And didn't even
knock on my dorm room door.
God, I definitely don't know like where this is going.
Yeah, he came in, told me I was pretty. It made me feel really sorry for him.
And then he raped
started
you.
Started kissing me.
Is that where this is going?
No,
just say
no,
it.
If that was happening, I would have just known it. This is not a rape story.
You promise? It sounds a whole
guys,
lot of rape story.
I literally just explained. That's what sex in college is.
This is so much fun.
Nobody asks in college.
It's
my baby shower. I think that's appropriate.
It wasn't like a stranger. You guys, we met at the cafeteria.
Oh, God. What is
going
on with
you
tonight?
That's
not date rape.
No, women in the future, this fucking amazing thing they used to serve. Oh, my God. It was like this foamy, light green, whipped jello shit with like
that.
Marshmallows in it.
What was that called?
Fantasia.
No,
it's Ambrosia.
It was Ambrosia.
It's Ambrosia.
You're doing
so
it.
Gross.
Amanda.
I make that all the time.
You still make it?
Yeah.
Where do you get the recipe for something like that?
She doesn't use recipes.
Bum.
She just...
What do you
say in my head?
What's your secret?
It's not really no secret. You just put stuff in it. It's Jell-O, and then you just add whatever you have. You know, fruit.
Okay.
Nuts.
You put nuts in it, Jell-O?
Yeah, you can put nuts in there. Cherries.
With the nuts?
Yeah.
Stop it. Would you stop it? When you bite down on a piece of Jell-O, you're not expecting a nut. That's what I'm saying.
So I got pregnant by this kid.
Oh, God, we're still on it.
I had to go back home to my parents' house in Chicago. Had to go to the local clinic. Got an abortion.
Did your parents know?
Yeah, my mom knew. I had to literally stay home the rest of my freshman year. I missed my freshman year. I didn't even go back to fucking USC because I couldn't face that kid. No way! No! So I just stayed home on my parents' couch. I watched soap operas for a year of my life. Oh my God. Oh my God, you guys, soap operas, they're gone.
Oh, sweet.
They're all gone.
So now we can go over to the PowerPoint. So why do I think that this scene is so important? I call it the Ambrosia scene, for lack of a better term. Because, let's go to the next one, please. Because it's obvious that her friends would rather talk about anything else, even if it's Jell-O, right? I mean, if you look at that scene, here's a woman who's with her closest friends. The blonde lady is her best friend, Stephanie. The main character is Rachel. Her best friend is Stephanie. And then Jenny, the woman looks cool, calm, and collected is the hostess. Amanda is the person who makes the ambrosia, and Meredith is the one who says Fantasia, oh, I love it, right? So we have a woman with five women, a woman named Rachel with four of her closest friends, one of which is her best friend, Stephanie, who thinks she knows her really well. They're really, really good friends. And yet, who is it that's trying the hardest to shut Rachel up? It's Stephanie, right? So here's this woman who's been carrying this secret for over 10 years now, at least 10 years. Nobody knows the story except her mother, because when she's asked, did your parents know? She says, my mother knew. Implication being her father didn't even know what had happened. So she goes off to college, as many young women do, full of excitement. And then in her very first week, she's sexually assaulted by someone, has to go home, is afraid to go back on campus, has to spend the whole year trying to recover and go back with her life. But obviously, it's still haunting her. It's still bothering her. And what happens when she tries to tell this story to her friends? So you all know the expression STFU, shut the blank up, right? And that's the response of her friends. And unfortunately, far too often, that's the response that people get when they try to talk about rape. Okay? So two extremely powerful documentaries are just released this year as Professor Andreopoulos, is that Andreopoulos? Okay. Mentioned The Hunting Grounds, directed by Kirby Dick. He's also the person who received an Academy Award nomination 2 years ago for the documentary The Invisible War, which was about rape in the military. The second one is by a New York filmmaker named Lisa Jackson, which was supported by an organization here in New York called Women Make Movies, and it's called It Happened Here. And these are two excellent, extremely powerful documentaries. There is some overlap between them, but The Hunting Grounds is much more focused at the macro level, at what's happening at the colleges, at the fraternities, and in big-time college sports. So you have to, like, understand that someone who was accused of rape, when there was a lot of physical evidence, got the Heisman Trophy and is now a number one draft choice for the NFL. So that's Kirby Dick is looking up. Lisa Jackson, on the other hand, is looking down. She's looking at the young women who have the courage to speak out on campuses and file Title IX complaints and Cleary complaints and actually push from the bottom up. So these are two excellent documentaries. You can see The Hunting Ground now at the Angelica, down on Houston Street. It Happened Here, a smaller budget, made by a woman, a more personal story, is having a very hard time with distribution. However, we have made arrangements, AAUW has made arrangements to have a special screening here in New York at the end of the month on March 29th at the Quad Theater at Union Square. So you can connect with me, we can get you all the information, and we hope we're going to have one of the young women who's a principal in the film, who's been an organizer at University of Connecticut, as our special guest for the Q&A. So to go back to the clip I showed you, these two documentaries provide a macro view of the issue of campus violence. They provide first-person accounts of victims as well as their family members and friends, and they provide expert analysis and great statistics on the number of rapes that are estimated and the under-reporting of rapes that we know do occur on campus, and the misreporting of rape, which is common across the board in all crimes, and I'm sure that Jennifer Gaffney could talk much more about this, but the misreporting is at most 8%. So that means 92% of the rapes that are reported are probably true, and the underreporting is a tremendous problem. So that's these two documentaries tell you a lot about the macro problem. But what does a documentary not do that a feature film like Afternoon Delight does do? And the answer is it puts us in the picture. Because when you're talking to the victim and you're talking to the family, and in some cases there's even a scene in It Happened Here where they're talking to a perpetrator who they fuzz out his face, but he's very eloquent about what he did and how he feels about it now afterwards. But what about us? What about her friends? What about her support network? So if you think about the clip I showed you and you ask yourself, what if you had been in that room? What if you were a friend of Rachel's, not just at the time of this clip that we're seeing that's 10 years or so after, but if you had been Rachel's friend at the time, what would you have done? So I'm not going to talk about it now, but if you'd like to talk about it in the Q&A, we certainly can. How many of you read the Rolling Stone article about University of Virginia? How many of you have heard about the Rolling Stone article about University of Virginia? Huge brouhaha. In fact, they mentioned it last night on the NewsHour on PBS. They were talking with Kirby Dick about his film, and the reporter from PBS actually referred to the UVA case as a case of misreporting of rape, which is insane, right? Because the whole point is it was never reported. But what was the problem in that case? The problem was that she didn't go at the time. Her friends not only didn't encourage her to seek medical attention regardless of whether or not she reported it, they did everything in their power to tell her to STFU. So I want to make you, through showing Afternoon Delight, the ambrosia scene, I want to make you think about what would your face have looked like when Rachel was telling this story. And what would you have said if Jill Soloway was filming you in that room? Would you have encouraged Rachel to tell her story? Would you have empathized? Would you have supported her need, as in any other post-traumatic stress disorder syndrome case, or would you have told her to shut up? So I want to just look at a couple of the words from the critics, and I have here the stats, that it's marginally fresh in Rotten Tomato terms. To be fresh on Rotten Tomatoes, you have to have 65% positive reviews. And so we have 68% reviews, 48 of which are fresh and 23 of which are rotten. I could talk forever about Rotten Tomatoes, but how many of you know what Rotten Tomatoes is? Maybe you even use it? Ah, there you go. So here you go. So here's an example of three comments, which I have on the handout, but I'll just take out my little pointer here. So what did the critics have to say about Afternoon Delight? They had to say it was an off-putting comedy about a two-idol Los Angeles woman, that Jill Soloway attempts to mask self-pity as enlightened self-criticism, and there are very much first-world problems. Nevertheless, the acting was good. What are these words telling Jill Soloway, the writer and director of Afternoon Delight? These critics are telling Jill to STFU. And the negative reviews did not just come from men, as we saw. So for you guys, you should feel, you know, empowered by the fact that women are just as egregious in this instance as men are, and sometimes even more. After all, in the scene we saw, it was five women together, right? There wasn't even a man in the room. So it's not the negative pushback, and the STFU phenomena is not men telling women not to speak. It's across the board, men and women telling women they don't want to hear their first world problems. The point of our project and the what American Association of University Women, AAUW, what we have been doing for over 125 years since 1881, we have been advocates for positive societal change. We believe in education as the mechanism for knowledge and growth and development, and education for women and education for all, equal access and equal opportunity for education. In this case, the reason why we started the Wittaswan Project, Support Women Artists Now, is to convince you that we in the audience have the power of the purse. If we support something, if we show that there is interest in the voices of women, we believe that just like all the other barriers, the marble ceiling, the glass ceiling, that the celluloid ceiling that restricts opportunities for women in film and makes it so difficult for women filmmakers to find their audience, we have the power to listen, to learn, and to make positive societal change. So connect with us.
Okay. Thank you, Jan.
Unfortunately, we didn't hear about the sexual assault at the international level, even though he mentioned that he was just going to bring it back home here. But my question is, can you, especially our lawyer, can you just tell us if there's an international, the New York Council District has any collaboration with the international level in terms of how they fight against women assaults when it comes to the war situations or even just some convention or treaties about that. Thank you very much for my question.
Well, in our office, we actually only have jurisdiction. I'm sorry. In our office, we only have jurisdiction to prosecute sexual assaults that happen here in New York State. So in terms of individual victims who are raped, we're only handling cases that happen, and I'm only handling cases that happened here in Manhattan. Every county has its own district attorney's office. In terms of international things, we do from time to time try to collaborate with prosecutors from other countries just to give ideas. What are you doing? What are we doing? So we've had visitors from I've been in my position for, I want to say, 10 years now. So for over the years, we've had visitors from Ireland, from the Congo, from Scotland, from Korea, prosecutors from different countries that have come to talk to us about how we're prosecuting our sexual assault cases and what some of our hurdles are, and we talk to them about what their hurdles are. And I will say that the laws are different from country to country. People's biases are very much the same. You know, when you meet prosecutors from other countries, we're certainly all dealing with the same sort of biases about how people should act before they're raped, how people should act after they're raped. Everybody has these ideas that everyone, you know, should, if you're raped, you should be crying, you should do this, you should do that. And so I think people's biases internationally are all the same, and prosecutors are sort of dealing with the same hurdles, but our laws are certainly different. Even, for example, in all of the United States and in New York, it's still a crime to rape your wife or sexually assault your husband. There's no defense of marriage. That's not true everywhere. Sometimes we meet victims who come to us who are living here in New York City, so they're raped by a partner, and they don't even know it's a crime because where they came from, it wasn't. And so there's an element of trying to educate the public, too, and educate our victims about what is a crime here and that they have rights here.
And I'll say also, here at John Jay, we do a lot of work, especially through the Women's Center, to address sexual violence, not just how it happens here, but how it happens all over the world. And especially, we are so privileged here to have such an incredibly diverse group of students and faculty and staff from all over the world that people bring different experiences and different cultures. And so we try to plan events and have awareness-raising activities to address sexual violence as it happens all over the world. I'll give you just one example. We did last spring, I think, we had a documentary. We show a lot of movies through the Women's Center, too. And we had a documentary filmmaker come who did an amazing movie about sexual violence. It was called Justice for My Sister. And I think, I want to say she's from Guatemala, but don't quote me on that. But we showed the film here, and we had the filmmaker come, and it raised a really great discussion, and there was a great Q&A afterwards about this filmmaker's experience, about kind of, you know, her privilege of being somebody who kind of was coming into the country, but not being from the country, and we talked about sort of how, you know, we can address these issues and also deal with what's happening here, you know. So it's great at John Jay, and we love doing those events where we look at sort of the larger context and we look at what's happening around the world and then also what's happening right here on campus. So we try to address that, and we're always collaborating with different departments and different student groups to do that.
So, there are filmmakers all around the world, women and men, who are trying to raise the red flag about sexual violence. A couple of weeks ago, some of you may know that at Barnard College, there's an annual event called the Athena Film Festival, which is dedicated to films by and about women. A couple of weeks ago, Maria and I were there, and we saw an unbelievably powerful film from Ethiopia called Defret. And it's about a 15-year-old girl who was on her way home from school in a village in Ethiopia when a gang of young men came up on horseback and literally stole her away, threw her into a barn. Then a young man who wanted to marry her came into the barn, locked the door behind him, raped her, and under the assumption that since she was no longer a virgin and no one else would want her, insisted with his father's family went to her family and said, no one will want her, but my son wants to marry her, and it was expected that this girl would just give in, and she didn't. So it's an amazingly powerful film about the woman who becomes her attorney, and a case, it's based on a true story that literally rocked Ethiopia. It was the first time that forced marriage was questioned, a huge tradition, a breaking of a barrier of a tradition of long-standing generations. Now, Ethiopia nominated this film for Best Foreign Language Film, and the mostly white, mostly male, mostly over 50 members of AMPAS, the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, chose not to name it as one of the five best foreign language films of the year, which is a disgrace. I saw all the nominees and many, many more, and I can tell you this was one of the best and most powerful films that I saw from any country last year. It was really spectacular. So yes, there are a lot of foreign language films from all around the world that deal with this issue that are available to you, but you need to know where to look and where to find them. And I hope part of our project is, and part of my job as Director of College and University Relations for Empire State Virtual Branch, AAUW, is to work with campuses and try to encourage you to see more of these films. So I'll just end by saying that another incredible man made a film about the rape in India that you probably heard about, that was 3 years ago, where the young woman was going home in a cab and she was assaulted so viciously that she died. Do you know which case I'm talking about in India just a couple of years ago? So this film was ready to be distributed about this case. The film is called India's Daughter. Just today on public radio, they reported that the Indian government will not allow this film to be seen in India. So this is what we're up against. We're up against people from the top of society to the bottom of society saying STFU to the stories of women.
Yes, Aphrodita.
Hi, good evening, everyone. Thank you for being here again. My question is more of an approach to males, the male perspective, and what I'm thinking is, I know that you said that there's a lot of preventive and proactive work being done to address the issue, but in your opinion, what do you think has been working in terms of transforming the male mindset of the so many males that are repetitively committing these crimes? I mean, have there been any certain programs that have actually been effective?
Yeah, I can certainly speak to that. I mean, I think there's two kind of issues that you bring up, and one is sort of the reforming piece of the people who are really kind of the core offenders. And that's another issue that I won't speak so much to right now, because there's a lot of different theories on sort of rehabilitation and punishment, and we could get into, you know, how we reform the prison systems and how we make programs more rehabilitative versus more punitive. But what I want to focus more on is sort of the bystander aspect that I had kind of spoke to briefly when I was presenting, and this idea that when we change what is socially acceptable and what is culturally acceptable, then behaviors start to change. Because, you know, if you are doing something and all of your friends are saying, that's not cool, that is such a different, it's going to give you such a different response than like we saw in the movie where people are saying, shut up, and, you know, ignoring it and not wanting to hear about it. So what we have done and what we're continuing to do, you know, we have found in the Women's Center that the best programs are the peer programs. It's when either, you know, students are talking to other students and kind of giving each other information and challenging each other when we're looking at these, you know, kind of rape myths and this idea that violence is just kind of acceptable and we don't think about it and we're desensitized to it in a lot of ways. So we try and get students involved in challenging, you know, one another. We do things like we just made a video about catcalling. There was this viral catcalling video that was all over the internet about this woman who had walked through the streets of New York City and just filmed, you know, and didn't respond to anything and all these kind of catcalls. So what we did was we had a videographer and we interviewed John Jay students to see what they thought about it and tried to just start the discussion. And what we are finding, and even, you know, having groups coming in to specifically sit like a group of men down to talk with other men. And how do we start to change the acceptance of violence and change kind of violence as a norm that we don't even recognize because we're not thinking about it? So we're starting really kind of small, but having students talking to other students, having men talking to other men, and trying to, from there, start the discussions that we're hoping are going to really, you know, get out into the larger campus community and then even into, you know, the larger world. But that's some of the things that we've been doing to specifically address those issues.
Anybody else? Yeah.
Do you want
to? Okay. I'm talkative. So yes, there are some very powerful films that show men in situations where other men are doing things that they know are wrong. And again, when you put yourself in that viewer's position, in the position where you're watching this, as in my clip, you have to ask yourself, if you're in that situation, what are you doing? And to run the movie in your head, am I speaking up? Am I doing what I know is right to do? Or am I not doing anything? And I think it's really, really important because a lot of times people at the time know that something bad is happening. They know that the woman is drinking too much, or they can see that she's been slipped something, some kind of drug, because she'll start to get woozy or dizzy. They can see her being led off to some place in a fraternity house. And there are now training programs for men to help them intervene as a group in situations, because the statistics show, and this is in both Kirby Dick's movie and in Lisa Jackson's movie, that it's actually a very small number of men who are the offenders. So that's why I'm putting so much emphasis on the other people there, not the victim, not the offender, but the other people there who should provide the support network for the victim if she's not able to defend herself in what's happening. Have any of you heard of a professor at Princeton called Kwame Anthony Appiah? Okay, so he has a book called The Honor Code. And this is, have you read it? So The Honor Code is one of my personal Bibles. And he gives a number of cases, dueling, slavery. And the one, of course, as a feminist that had the most impact on me is on foot binding. So there can be traditions that are traditions for centuries that are never questioned, like in Defret, the case of, what is that called, bride robbery, or there's a term for it. But you know, when you decide you want to marry someone and you go and swoop her up and you know carry her away and take her virginity and assume that she's now your possession. There's also a very good movie from Georgia that used to be part of the Soviet Union, the state of Georgia, from Tbilisi, Georgia, called In Bloom, that was shown at the Film Society of Lincoln Center last year with the same kind of scenario. A young girl is waiting online at the store, and a car comes up, and the guy and his friends get out, put her in the car. Anyway, these kinds of things that no one has questioned for centuries, sometimes a film can put you in the position of watching this and saying, I was there and I did nothing. And when enough people realize that they should have done something and did nothing, like with foot binding, all of a sudden things can change. And a generation later, people can say, how did anybody ever think that foot binding was a good idea? How did anybody ever think that rape was a good idea? So it's up to us, and that's why I believe in the power of art, and I've said too much, so.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, yes, sure.
Hi, I'm one of the research assistants. My name's Caitlin. My question, I'm sorry.
Microphone?
Yeah, sorry.
Oh, okay.
My question is for all of the panelists, but particularly Jessica. So I know you mentioned the preventative steps that John Jay's taking, getting students together to speak about these issues openly, mm-hmm. and to brainstorm ideas on how to intervene in situations where they should. And in instances where something is reported to the school and say it doesn't rise to the point at which it can be prosecuted, what are the steps that the school usually takes? I know you mentioned it briefly, but what are the steps that the school takes so that students are aware of what happens going forward?
Sure. So there's a couple questions there that I can certainly speak to. And one is, you know, we have, there are discipline, like if there's a violation of the policy, there are supportive resources for the survivor and punitive resources for the perpetrator, right? So we have our own college process. If the Title IX investigator does the investigation and determines that a policy violation happened, then it can go to a hearing and there can be sanctions from a warning to expulsion. So it really depends on, you know, kind of what happened, what kind of evidence she's able to gather, and we have our own college process in terms of If there's a violation of the policy, then there are punitive measures that are taken. In terms of supporting the survivor, we have a whole host of services that we can do. And it, you know, it doesn't have to even rise to the level that there was a violation of New York State law or even a violation of the policy, but we work with people to provide counseling. Some students would prefer to get counseling not on campus, so I work with people to really connect them with different resources. There are kind of hospital-based programs where you can get counseling for free. There are other sort of advocacy-type services that people can get. And we also, you know, provide kind of accommodations for, you know, if somebody needs to change a class or if somebody needs their schedule changed or if somebody needs to withdraw from their classes, we help facilitate that so that there's no academic penalty. So there are certainly, you know, a lot of resources on campus and off campus. Whether or not this goes outside of the college, we are set up to really be able to provide students the best experience that we can so that they're able to stay in school and that they're able to, you know, continue with their education because that's really why they're here.
Any other questions? Okay.
Can I just, on the back of the handout.
Sorry, there was one, sorry.
Oh, whoops.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Hi, I'm Steph. I'm also a research assistant here. My question is also geared more towards you, but what about encouraging male victims to come forward, especially since you hear rape, and you, I guess when you think of rape, you kind of assume it's a woman being attacked,
right.
And rape is always attached to women's resource centers on college campuses. So what can institutions do to encourage male victims?
Yeah, that's a really great question. And it's complicated, and we also know that, you know, most violence is perpetrated by men against women, but there are certainly male victims. And that was one of the reasons why I kind of joke about my title being like, a gazillion miles long, but we wanted to really specify that even though I'm in the Women's Center, I'm a resource for gender-based violence. So we didn't want to say like the women's violence advocate, you know. So we have different resources on campus specifically for men. Sometimes men don't feel comfortable coming to talk to me just because I'm housed in the Women's Center. But we have a urban male initiative and we work very collaboratively. And so there are services that are provided there. I also meet with people and refer them out to get supported services. It's challenging because we also know that even though, you know, we think statistically there's less violence being perpetrated against men, men are also less likely to report. So we try and do things. We provide services through UMI. We have, for our LGBTQ students, we have now an LGBTQ services coordinator. And we are trying to encourage people to report. And that's one of the reasons, like, we came up with this policy. It's so comprehensive. And we're trying to get the word out that resources exist so students even know that they're available and then they can utilize them. Our counseling department is also a great resource. And I work closely with them to kind of help facilitate referrals in that area, too. So we are doing a lot of work to try and be inclusive. At the same time, the Women's Center was created because students advocated for it, and they felt that there wasn't a safe space for women students on campus. So we're trying to honor that as well, and it's a little bit of a balancing act, but we feel very passionately that the Women's Center needs to exist for women students and for allies. But we do have services for men as well.
The Kirby Dick film, The Hunting Ground, specifically includes male victims of campus rape as well as female victims, although, again, it's a preponderantly female victims. There are some very well-drawn cases of male victims and also mentions statistically how hard it is to get men to report. I just wanted to, on the back of the handout that I gave you is the AAUW toolkit, and I wanted to just bring your attention to the Talking Points memo on campus sexual assault. If you are going to take it on yourself to be a spokesperson for campus sexual assault remediation, you're going to want to look at that, because if you try to speak on this point, you are likely to get told STFU. So you're going to want to have your replies ready for when people say to you, I don't want to hear about it.
Okay, we have time for one more question. So.
Okay, good evening, everyone. My name is Majed. I'm also an undergraduate here. I actually have two. They're short, so. The first question is for Ms. Jennifer Gaffney. There's one of your slides stated that if a defendant is prosecuted, criminal record is permanent. Can you clarify this a little more? Because I would thought that if a defendant is convicted, a criminal record will be permanent.
I think it should have said if he was successfully prosecuted, meaning that we obtain a conviction. You're
you're looking at a potential future attorney's here, so.
Yes. No. If you're arrested and we do not and you're not convicted, then it's sealed.
Okay.
If,
great.
If there's an acquittal.
The second question is for Ms. Jessica. Mm-hmm. How would you? It's regarding confidentiality. How would you cope with something? For an example, a student walks into your office, tell you that she or he was violently raped, and she's seeking confidentiality. I mean, how do you cope with something like this as an individual, knowing there's like a perpetrator is in the loose or in the street that could commit it again?
Well, that's a very good question. I think that, you know, I've done this for a long time, and I have seen the importance in victims being empowered, right? And that's why sometimes we talk about them, survivors versus victims, but I think that what happens is I take confidentiality very seriously, and someone may come and talk to me and disclose something and not be ready to report, but need that space to kind of process and get the information to make an informed choice. They may decide they never want to report. People have lots of different reasons for why they do what they do. But if I were to say, you have to do this, you need to do this, I'm gonna make you do this, that's disempowering to somebody. And that's, you know, you can think of it as re-victimizing somebody who is just victimized. So I take it very seriously. You know, I think that giving people all of the information and all of the resources and then helping them through making their own informed decision is the most important part of what I do. It's one of the most important parts. And I also think that, you know, sometimes people will decide to report later. And it's great if they can report right away, but not everybody is ready to do that. And, you know, if somebody is in need of medical attention, I would certainly encourage them to get medical attention. Again, if it's a larger campus safety issue, that changes some of my obligations a little bit. Or in the case that somebody's a danger to themselves or others, then that sort of trumps the confidentiality piece. But for the most part, it's really about not disempowering people who have just been victimized. So that's kind of how I see it. You know, that said, it's very challenging, but it's also a really rewarding job. So I hope that answered your question.
Okay. Well, first of all, let me say that we can continue the conversation over food and beverages, so please don't go, and you can continue the discussion with our speakers. A program note, 2 weeks from today, on the 19th of March, we are going to have our next event, which is part of our series of events on mental health issues, which has been the focus of the center for the last year and a half. And the event will be a panel discussion on mass incarceration and mental health issues. So it's going to be again here in this room from 6 to 8, and I very much hope that you can join us for this, which brings me to my next point. Those of you who have not yet signed our sign-up sheet, please do so that we can put you on our listserv and notify you about our upcoming events. So this brings us to the end of the formal part of the evening. I'm sure you'll join me in thanking Jan, Jessica, and Jennifer for their presentations.